Welcome to the Unlicensed Podcast. I am Caleb. As always, we're joined by Tassos.
Hey.
And this week, we're happy to be hosting Keefe John from Ethoplex and WISP. So, Keefe, really appreciate you taking the time to join us today. We're going to talk about WISP life, WISP, or I don't know, whatever you want to talk about. This is just a conversation we're having here. So right before we jump in, do intros and stuff, Tassos, you want to give the good people out there their call to action?
Absolutely. Don't forget to like, listen, and subscribe to our channel right here on YouTube or anywhere you download your audio podcasts like Apple, Google, or Spotify.
Cue the music. All right, Keefe. Hey, man. Really appreciate you taking the time out of your busy day. I know you're slammed. So for those out there that know you, you know, say hi. But for those that don't know you especially, just give a quick introduction and maybe a little bit of history about, you know, how you got into this madness. You know, what's your path to get here?
Sure. Thanks for having me. I'm Keefe. I have a WISP in Wisconsin. We've been running it since 2004. So we're coming up on 20-year anniversary. And how did I get into it? You know, it's an interesting story. When I was in high school, I actually worked at another IFT, actually a WISP member at the time, Networks, and they were doing dial-up internet and just starting to get into Canopy wireless. And I thought I was really excited. Ended up leaving there and doing a couple things. And then I started a computer shop, always exciting. And we sort of over time. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I was totally a nerd. We sort of like evolved into a WISP over time, you know, from our basic beginnings as a computer shop and started deploying fixed wireless. And it's been a lot of fun ever since.
Very cool. You know, that's a very sort of similar start to a lot of people we've talked to, a lot of people in this industry. You know, you get started in some technical field and then see a demand there and grow. And it's really, you know, it's a cool thing to see so many WISPs out of our fiber hybrid or whatever you want to call it nowadays, you know, really just kind of came from the ground up and grew it organically and, you know, filling the needs for the community and stuff. So where in Wisconsin, are you located and what areas do you serve?
So we're maybe 20 minutes north of Milwaukee and we service roughly the eastern half of the state. Yeah.
Okay.
And I wanted to back up on one thing. We actually sort of got our first wireless tower on accident. It was interesting. Like, I always really wanted
to be.
How does that happen? It was interesting. I always wanted to be an ISP, but we were like going down the computer shop MSP path. And, you know, probably around maybe 2007, 2008, these like investors came in with big money from Colorado and they said, we're going to build this huge WISP in Wisconsin. They had like hundreds of thousands of dollars. They built this network with like three or four towers and predictably they wasted all the money.
Yeah.
They were actually paying us to do their installs and we ended up doing like 10 of them because they had like maybe 20 customers. They ended up never paying us for all our work. We were doing like some network work for that too. And one day they called me up and they're like, hey, we're going out of business. And so okay. We're sorry about that, but all that money we owe you, how about this? We'll just give you the whole network. You can have our office equipment and all the equipment and the towers and just let's call it even. So we were like, all right, let's do it.
Wow. That sounds like you got a good deal there.
It was a good deal. It was really old stuff. It was, remember like the original Proxim tsunami gear?
Oh, geez. Yeah.
It was super old. And then they had...
It wasn't cheap back then, though. That stuff wasn't cheap.
It wasn't. They were actually, in addition to like fixed wireless, they were trying to do the whole like community or citywide Wi-Fi.
Had
Wi-Fi APs on people's houses and telephone poles.
You're making my brain hurt now.
Yeah, it was kind of a disaster. I mean, they had lofty goals.
Remember like Tropos mesh and stuff like that?
It was mesh, yeah.
Yeah, it always has to be. That's the only way to do outdoor Wi-Fi, always.
I mean, these guys like really believed in it. They're like, we're gonna mess this whole city.
They still do everything.
It's gonna be awesome.
Yeah. Single, and it was all single radio mesh back then and stuff too, right? So that was like even worse. The worst possible architecture you can have, you know. And people still think that mesh is the way to do things. It's getting better because it's not like mesh is getting better. I think it's a lot of it is the same. It's just the radios are getting faster. It was always about that bottleneck, you know. I remember when they came out with dual radio, I'm like, all right, that's better. So you can have one be like the backhaul, you know, for the mesh, and the other one to serve subscribers and stuff like that. But I've still yet to see a successful deployment like that.
And, you know, I think I saw the writing on the wall when I attended a corporate meeting with them. And on the agenda, there was a discussion item on who was going to change the light bulb in the office.
Okay.
Brimming with confidence after that meeting, right? So, yeah, I would love to know just over the years how many billions of dollars have been lit on fire with people trying to do citywide mesh Wi-Fi networks, you know? And it sounds like it just gets a new coat of polish on that business plan before it gets run back out the next time. It's just like, oh my god, you guys. Mm-hmm. So
yeah,
there's way too much waste. I mean, do you guys remember Open Range? I think they blew through $100 million or something. They have some towers around here, never had any customers, but they had all these towers and expensive gear.
Nuts.
You know, so much of that. I think the only one that kind of worked was Ricochet. So I was in Atlanta in college, and they had Ricochet, which is like the 900 megahertz, I believe. That was late 90s, early 2000s. That was the first time we were driving down the road, like on the web, pulling like a meg or 2 meg speed test. We're going 70 miles an hour down the heart of Atlanta. I'm like, the future is here. And then they figured out insanely expensive and was never going to really scale. But for the time, it was glorious for a minute. I mean, that's kind of what kind of lit the fires for, like, we can put this here internet stuff everywhere. So good times.
There were some other guys in this area who tried to do something with Nazini. You guys ever see their gear?
Mm-hmm.
It was, I don't know, they thought it was magic. They're like, it's going to work underground. It's going to work in the sewers. It's going to work through the trees, everything. Wow. And it sucked predictably.
Yeah.
Yes, the harsh hand of physics slaps you once again, right? So, so you've been at this a while. I mean, obviously, you know, one of the things I like to talk about, especially with someone who's been doing this a while, is kind of the technical evolution of your tech stack. You know, for whether it's distribution or middle mile or whatever else, you know. I saw you recently posted some pictures on WISP Talk or something. You're like, here's our first data center, just kind of a hodgepodge of things, right? So you give us the quick nickel tour. We'll put on the nostalgia glasses and kind of run through, like, you know, what really worked, you know, how has your network evolved over time? And, you know, really, where's your focus now and the type of bandwidth you're trying to deploy and stuff like that?
Sure. Yeah. You know, that post really brought me back. I was just going through my Google Photos and I found it, and I was reminded that, like, when we started out, we had like zero money. We didn't have any loans. We had maybe a few $1,000, and we actually got a lot of our equipment dumpster diving.
Yeah.
Local businesses, you know, finding servers and stuff. But, you know, looking back, I'm sort of embarrassed by some of our first installs. I think a lot of them are. But you have to start somewhere.
Yeah.
And, you know, with limited funds, you're on a shoestring budget. So you got to bootstrap. And, now, obviously, we do things a lot differently now than we did 20 years ago. And, you know, we're always getting better radios, better backhauls, DC power plants.
You'll probably in 10, 15 years from now, look back at where you are today, and you'll be embarrassed again, right?
Right.
We use drip loops? Wow, geez. You know?
Yeah, what the hell was I thinking? Yeah,
exactly.
You know, so we started with Canopy PMP 100, so like their first product, right when they were coming out with like the upgrade. There was like a software upgrade to I think it was called Advantage. It made it like PMP 200, so it did 14 meg total, 10 down.
Yeah.
And so now we're deploying, you know, Ubiquity stuff, Mimosa, some bicells, a lot of license links. We love Aviat. They make some awesome links.
Hmm.
The wealth of information that's available now too is so much more than it used to be. You know, so much of in those sort of times you were just reinventing the wheel every time. So, you know, when some of the quote unquote newer WISPs, the guys have been at this a few years, you know, 5 years and stuff, they've made tremendous amount of progress, so much faster than you could then. But I mean, there was just, you know, WISP is the whole thing, the shows where you can meet people and learn, you know, all the forums and stuff like that. You know, it's just so much more info is available. I'm not saying it's easy by any stretch of the imagination, but, you know, you're not pioneering and rebuilding from scratch every single thing you're doing, which is super helpful.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's just crazy how the internet itself helped, you know, all the forums and places you can go, and now on social media, like you said, and not reinvent the wheel. You know, you ask the question and be like, okay, they did that and this is how they fix it. And you start at a much higher level than where everybody else started. I mean, I remember when I first got involved in wireless, I don't want to say I wanted to be a WISP. I don't know anybody who ever says, you know, I wanted to be a WISP when I grew up, you know, but I definitely wanted to get, you know, into wireless. So I started looking into the industry as a whole, and I wanted to do MDUs, right? So back then, the triple play was like the holy grail, right? So my biggest thing was trying to, you know, figure out VoIP back then, right? And it was in the early stages, so I was like buying, you know, ATAs from like Vonage, Packet 8, and all these different companies, try white label it, you know, because I didn't have the money to start my own, you know, VoIP gateway and do all the stuff that you needed there, right? And I remember like upstairs in my living room, I had like eight Packet 8 ATAs with little $7, you know, like the analog telephones, and hook them up into it, and, you know, connecting to my AP outside. And I was using D-Link like access points back then, like little indoor routers as the CPEs, and doing all this stuff. And I'd like call the other number, I'd pick up the phone, I'd pick up the phone, I'd be like, hello, hello, and I'd listen for the echo, see if there was jitter. And just, I mean, it is embarrassing, like you said, to think how we went about things to try and figure things out, because there was nobody to really ask, you know. And obviously eventually things got better, and, you know, people started communicating and talking about this stuff. But yeah, I think we've all done some silly stuff trying to figure it out on our own back in the day.
Yeah, my first was wet 11s outside, wrapped in a trash bag on like a pipe sucking a bucket or something, because we needed a temporary link.
Is that IP67 certified?
I don't know. Exactly, 100%.
Better put a drip hole there.
Yeah, exactly. We were moving, and we had SDSL, which was symmetrical DSL, like the only ones in that part of Atlanta that had it. We had to move from one apartment to the next because we had a COBOL email server we were hosting or some nonsense. Yeah. So we're like, oh, we just got to shoot this link down here for a month that it took for him to move the circuit over. So we're like, oh, this is all wireless stuff. This is a piece of cake. How hard can it be? So
yeah. You know, I'm not proud of it, but one of our first towers, we had the backhaul with a cable modem from a local cable company for a little while until we got our links up, but it worked and got the job done.
Yeah. There are a lot of those networks got started by residential class DSL and stuff. They've gotten a little more persnickety about that sort of thing anymore, but it was back in the day, they didn't know. So
exactly.
You'd spoof the Mac. You had to like spoof the Mac to put it into a router or whatever. Yeah. It's been a
good
minute.
Stuff.
So okay. So, you know, now you're using the pretty sort of common, you know, tech stack, lots of Aviat stuff, lots of backhauls, 80 gig, you know, these are the things that we see a lot. Are you doing any fiber yet? Whether it's in network, you know, just your own, are you looking to deploy any fiber, or where are you at on that?
You know, we're not going to do any fiber. You know, we do some reselling of other circuits to get the enterprise clients and MDUs, but we don't want to be digging ditches and putting fiber in the ground. I guess I'm a wireless maxi. I think there's still a ton of opportunity for WISP with enterprise and MDUs, and even going head to head with cable companies, you know, using 6 gigahertz and millimeter wave to provide gigabit service. So I'm all in on wireless. No plans to do fiber right now, but I know a lot of people are, and they're being successful at it, and that's awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, it depends so much on your location and your environment and stuff too, right? So, I mean, you're in Wisconsin, north of Milwaukee. So it's pretty chilly a good portion of the year. I'd imagine it's really rocky and stuff like that. So, you know, you see someone, they're like, oh, fiber's so easy. And then it's just basically open land, you know, we're digging along dirt roads for 100 miles, right? And they're like, all you got to do is put it in the ground and the plow, yeah, and the dirt's all sand or whatever, right? So they're like, okay, that's a little bit different than it is somewhere up north or out east in the mountains and stuff
like
that.
Come down here to the hill country.
We actually did a small amount of fiber in a business park here, and it was extremely rocky, huge pain in the butt.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's just, you know, so much dependent on what the environment is. But that's, I mean, one of the great things about a WISP and the amount of tools that are in a toolbox available now. So you've got a lot of options, and, you know, you got to deploy what makes sense for your region and your area, not to mention your customer base, your demographics and stuff like that. So, you know, it's all about making the decisions of what is great for, you know, someone in one location might not make any sense for you where you are. So, you know, it's when you hear success stories, and, you know, sometimes I'm not trying to be like pessimistic, but I warn people, they're like, well, these guys are doing it, I can do it too. I'm like, yeah, sure, you could. But, you know, there's a lot of things that you've got to consider what makes sense for your area. You know, you're not going to build a, you know, 10,000 sub wave 60 gig millimeter network, you know, if you're out in, you know, like where we are, you know, we're in a tree hell in this part of North Carolina, right?
Yep.
So, you know, it's super difficult, but someone out in Oklahoma, Texas, or maybe, you know, it's, you can serve a lot of subdivisions where it makes a lot of sense. So, you know, you can't just hit everything with one big hammer. You have a collection of different hammers, I suppose.
Yeah. And there's always a bunch of different niches to look for also. I mean, there's a lot of very unique opportunities out there, you know, and I think, you know, WISP should be looking for those particular ones, you know, going into some areas where, you know, you can kind of, you know, team up with somebody, you know, like all these new developments and home, you know, in the suburbs and stuff where they're already digging up the road and putting in conduit and stuff like that, making relationships with those developers and stuff like that to make your job a little bit easier and bring some value to them as well. So there's a lot of little niches, I think, that you can look for, not only in, you know, fiber, but in wireless as well, you know?
Yeah, I've noticed there's a lot of wireless niches, and there's a lot of companies making big money in a very specific market in wireless.
Correct. Yep.
The other day I heard of a rather large company, they only do Wi-Fi in like parks and trailer parks. And they're making a killing. There's a lot of companies who are just doing Wi-Fi and MDUs, and they have tens of thousands of customers.
Exactly.
So I think the future is bright for the wireless industry.
It is. You just have to, just got to keep looking. You know, got to keep looking.
You have to adapt.
For sure. Yeah, and one of the greatest things about the community is you've got access to a lot of ideas, but one of the things that can also bite you there is sometimes it does get to be a little bit of tunnel vision, perhaps, or, you know, hot news of the week, right? So, you know, especially in, you know, things like WISP Talk or something, you'll hit a stretch where something is the hot topic. So, you know, maybe this quarter, it's everyone wanting to focus on fiber, and then they ADD over to Toronto, and then now it's, you know, millimeter or whatever else, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
It's easy to get caught up and say, okay, this is what everybody's doing, without just taking a step back and saying, okay, this is a focus of what people want to talk about. You know, it's the current hot thing, but you also need to realize, hey, you know, what the implications are and everything else. So it's, you know, it's both super beneficial, but, you know, like anything else on the internet, you have to take it with a little bit of grain of salt and use a little bit of cognitive reasoning to make sure, hey, this is what's really happening versus this is the most popular happening. And that's why I think the conversations online are great, but, you know, with the shows and stuff, I think it is super helpful to meet people in real world and do that sort of networking and stuff there too. You know, I've started getting random emails about the Vegas show coming up, and I'm like, nah, that's a year away from now, right?
And it seems like it.
No, that's 5 months or whatever it is. I'm like, oh God, it's about that time again. So, where you are in Wisconsin, I mean, other than it being freezing cold, of course, you know, I'm lived in the South my entire life. So anything below 40 is like, you know, I'm on Hoth or something, right? So
Arctic,
you know, other than dealing with the, I guess, the cold and stuff, what for your region, you know, what are some of your biggest challenges in terms of environmental or, I mean, demographic and stuff like that? Like, Where are you running into issues, and you know, how are you solving those kind of issues?
You know, I mean, there's always issues. You know, environmental, there's a lot of trees and a lot of hills here. And that's probably our number one challenge, actually connecting customers. A couple of years ago, I ran a report, and it was, we were turning away like 50% of our leads.
Wow.
Just because we could not service them. And it wasn't just the trees. There was a lot of hills as well, and nothing really goes to the hills. Maybe TV white space, but that doesn't work all that well.
Let's not go there. that's on the level with mesh.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's like, let's not go there. So, I mean, on these installs, I mean, obviously, it's all about getting altitude on your CPEs. I mean, you guys using push-up poles. I mean, does your WISP customer look like, you know, the ones that we've seen with a 20-foot push-up pole on the, you know, the peak of their house with guy wires and stuff like that? Or,
I mean, yeah, it's our mission to do whatever we can to service the customer. Mm-hmm. So we've built little round 25 towers for people. We've put it on their silo and, you know, ran aerial over to their house or done a point to point. We've even done a couple tree installs, which are interesting. But yeah, masts, tripods, we'll do whatever we can, you know, as long as the customer's okay with it. Sometimes they're like, oh, that's ugly.
It's like, okay, here's what it looks like with no internet.
Right.
That's worse. Let's plug it back in. We're good.
Yeah, you'd be surprised. Like some people with million-dollar homes, they're like, yeah, put in it. We'll take a tripod and a 20-foot pipe. Then some other person, like, absolutely.
They know the value of internet. That's why. That's why they have a big ass expensive house. Because we won't have that without internet.
Other people are like, I don't want any holes in my house. I want a hole in my yard. You can't mount anything to my siding.
Yeah.
Like, do you want internet or not?
Yeah, yeah. Well, you try and do. I mean, I understand that, too. People like their stuff to look nice or whatever. So I guess it's up to them to decide, you know, what's their pain level for that kind of stuff. How about, like, dish sizes, right? Because that's always something that interests me. And when I hear the debates, you know, with WISPs, right, on, you know, you want the smallest dish, like you said, you know, because, you know, they want it to be kind of hidden and nothing. And there's some WISPs I heard are install like 3 or 4 foot dishes on people's houses, maybe not 4 foot, but definitely 3 foot, right, because that's what it requires to make that link, you know, for whatever that distance is. How are you guys on that kind of stuff?
You know, I would say we've always erred towards larger dishes. Like, we've never done anything small, like an station or anything.
Right, yeah, yeah.
You know, we've always,
that's just garbage,
like, like light beams or power beams. We always tell a customer the dish is going to be like a dinner plate or bigger.
Right.
And we have done like 2 foot dishes on people's houses, but never a 3 foot.
Okay. What about, so you're talking about your clients where you're having to turn down and stuff like that. You know, so much quality mapping software and stuff's come up about LiDAR data has become, you know, so in your area, you know, do you have good LiDAR data where you can sort of be a lot more accurate on your mapping, or what does that look like for you where you are?
For sure. We do have LiDAR data here. As you know, our mapping has gotten more accurate in the last couple of years with tools from like tower coverage, ubiquity, CNE. So it is a lot better. You know, we've been able to increase our sort of conversion ratio and get more accurate, which has been really helpful. But at the end of the day, those things are not 100% accurate still.
Yeah.
They can't account for everything. So I've sort of made it a philosophy to always try to do whatever we can to service the customer. So if I have to send a tech out, you know, 10 times for a failed install to get one, I'd rather do that than turn away one customer I could have serviced.
Right, right. So you're using all those tools at the same time, or is there, I mean, what's your kind of go-to qualifying a customer link? And then what would be your, like, if that proves to be maybe marginal, is there another software or another application you go to, or is it like putting somebody to drive out to that location and test the signal itself?
Yeah,
what's your process?
Our process is, you know, we have sonar, so we use some of the built-in tools in sonar.
Mm-hmm.
We have to use Google Earth quite a lot and the ubiquity tool. From there, we would just do a site survey if it looks good or if it's questionable.
Yeah, you really got to lean on the edge of being kind of conservative and not just taking the data for gospel like anything else, right?
Right, so, right, right.
But yeah, there's been tons of advancements there, which really help out for sure. Now, are you mainly residential or a mix between residential and business? Or
so we are a mix, and more we're doing more enterprise business and DUs and residential, which I think is a really strong market for WISP that I think everybody should look into it. You can get higher MRC clients. They're more sticky. They last longer.
Yeah. So when you say MDU, I mean, what's that look like? I mean, you're providing bandwidth to the MDU. I mean, are you running Cat 5 into their apartments, fiber, 60 gig? I mean, what's that look like?
So, you know, there's a big technology stack there. We do a lot of things, but, you know, our basic setup is bring in some kind of connectivity to an MDU, whether it's fiber circuit or a microwave circuit, like 80 gigahertz or 60 gigahertz. Could be AVIA, could be air fiber 60. We bring it in, then we wire it into every unit. We try to find MDUs that have that wiring already in there. So a lot of them that we do are new construction, which is nice because they scoped out, you know, Cat 6 to every unit. So we'll go in, put a router, put some switches, and then do common area Wi-Fi. Sometimes we'll do like a building-wide Wi-Fi where we'll put like an Alta Labs AP in every unit. We'll use their Alta Pass. So every apartment has their own private network while still using the same SSID. That's worked out really well, actually. Love the product.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I mean, that's a fairly new name in this market now. Again, it's not really... I don't want to say it's not part of the WISP world, but it's really enterprise or indoor. I mean, what's the scoop with this Alta company?
You know, Alta is awesome. They were started by some former Ubiquity people. I think Ben Moore, Matt Hardy's there, some others. Can't remember their names, but they have some awesome products. I think they're priced comparable to Ubiquity, maybe even a little less expensive. But what I like about them is they are really rapidly developing. Like if you want a feature, they'll put it out in a couple weeks or a couple months, not like the soon thing we get from other vendors. Yeah.
Hashtag soon.
Yeah. I think they're hungry for business and they're really making strides in the industry.
Cool.
We use them in a lot of our MDUs. They also just came out with a outdoor AP, which is pretty cool.
Yeah. I saw that on social media. I thought that was cool.
Yeah.
Neat.
Yeah, there's been a lot of advancements in that state that allow you to sort of divvy up that network and put individual users on their own network. You know, I haven't played with the MDU game is 8-9 years now, I guess, at this point, you know, back when I was doing that. You know, back then it was just, okay, here's the community Wi-Fi, here's your password or whatever, and you couldn't control being on your own net unless, you know, you had a drop in or running the unique SSID, which worked. But then you would not have resources to, you know, you wouldn't be on the same network if you hopped in the community, if you went out to the quad or whatever else, right? And now there's a lot of different ways where you can still print to your printer and get access to devices no matter where you are on the property. And, you know, things that are kind of commonplace now, like I would have loved to have had that years ago when I was in that space. You know, it just gives you way more flexibility. And you know, the MDU stuff is actually really interesting. You know, I know, or we know, you know, multiple ISPs that are starting to work in that space. And what they found is, you know, they already have the mindset of doing that sort of end user connection management, tech support and stuff, where a lot of times, like, you know, when a community or an apartment building or whatever, like, bids this out to an MSP, you know, a lot of times these MSPs might understand, you know, the tech side of things, but not the actual, like, customer management. They're used to supporting businesses and not the individual user, not be understanding the pain that it takes when grandma gets a new iPad and she can't figure out how to get it online, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's one of those spaces, I think, where a WISP can really excel in and compete. And, you know, deliver a really good end product and pick up, you know, hundreds of customers at a time. So, you know, it's really encouraging. Like you said, the new builds, most of them have pre-existing wiring. There's a lot of cool stuff now even if there's not existing wiring with like the little tiny baby GPON stuff where you can run the fiber along, you know, the molding and stuff like that. There's been a lot of advances in that space. So, you know, in the end, you still want to get that access point as close as you can, you know, in unit, just so you're not dealing with, you know, shooting through 18 layers of concrete to get them like anything else. But, you know, in the end, it's, you know, once you get that network turned up, I mean, it can be a cash cow if you do it right. So there's tons of opportunities there for sure.
Definitely.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, we try to sell it to the landlord as a profit center. So we're not just going in trying to sell them something that's going to be
smart. Yep.
We show them how they can monetize broadband in their building and actually make an ROI on broadband. Generally, if they do like a partnership with a local cable company, they might get a small monthly commission. It's not that big, maybe 5 or 10%. But if they actually buy bulk from us and resell it to their tenants, like built into rent or different line items, they're going to make 50% margin or more on that broadband in the property.
Yeah, that helps tremendously. Of course, dealing with a WISP is going to be way easier than dealing, you know, with your local cable juggernaut and stuff like that. So, you know, especially in an area where the housing is really competitive, then, you know, anything to ease that friction of a new user moving in, they could have internet the day they move in, quality service, so on and so forth. You know, again, for them, it's a win-win, you know, on the customer service for the owner of the property, plus, you know, the money they're making on top of it. So lots of good opportunities there for sure.
For sure. Yeah, that's one of our big business areas. But something related to that we're getting into is sort of the DY space or DPIN, the decentralized physical infrastructure and decentralized wireless, things like Helium and XNet. So, you know, what we can do is we deploy this network in the MDU. We can connect it to XNet and other offload partners. We can get paid per gig for transporting traffic for AT&T and other cell companies in these properties and on these wireless networks, which is pretty cool.
Oh, that's neat.
Yeah, that's definitely an area I'm completely ignorant in.
Same.
You know, there was, you know, I guess a year or two ago, there was a big splash for, I guess, Loran, you know, tied to Helium, and it kind of blew up. But then all of a sudden it's back. And I don't really understand, you know, what's really driving that or, you know, where this makes sense other than, you know, at first it really seemed like it was just one of these crypto bandwagon things. But now I think it seems to be a lot more mature and actually makes a lot of sense, you know, something that people can invest in and will be there for the long term. So, I mean, any light you can shed on that, I mean, I think the folks out there would, you know, love to learn something if you can share.
Sure. Well, right now, like the two big projects would be Helium and XNet, and their focus is providing Wi-Fi offload to the cell company. So when the cell companies don't have service in the area, or maybe their tower's overloaded, people's cell phones will connect to your Wi-Fi network and you get paid for transporting that traffic for them. So I guess the goal of XNet and Helium is to deploy these wireless access points in high traffic locations and then collect as much data from the cell carriers as you can. And it actually works surprisingly well. We put one up at a large apartment building and we could actually see how many people connect to it. And like 45 or so AT&T phones connected to it within a day, which is quite interesting.
Wow.
Neat. And then you get paid per gig for any traffic going over it.
And what? So, what? I mean, can you share some of that? Like how much you get? I mean,
you know, with Helium, you get 50 cents a gig. With XNet, their token is like going all over the place right now, but it's $3 or $4 a gig.
Right.
But I think that will come down. I think industry rates are between like 10 to 50 cents a gig, depending on the carrier. Sometimes $1 a gig if it's like a good location or maybe international cell phone company roaming here. But, you know, with our deployments, we've made tens of thousands of dollars already. So I think it's definitely worthwhile for WISPs to look into it.
Now, what's the average cost of the equipment roundabout?
You know, it can range from $500 or a Helium outdoor access point to, you know, Alta Labs is a XNet partner. I think their access point is $199. So $200 to $500.
So you're basically just, you're adding additional access points in some fashion that ties into their ecosystem. So the turn up process seems like it's pretty straightforward. I mean, you got to register for accounts and all that other stuff. But in the grand scheme of things, you're just tagging distribution hardware to a network you've already got. And it kind of runs from there and, you know, makes, you know, not killer money immediately, but I mean, additional reoccurring revenue is, you know, always eyes on the prize. So it seems like implementation is relatively straightforward.
Yeah, for sure. You know, the money is small, but like over volume and over time, you know, it really adds up. What's cool about the XNet project is you can leverage existing hardware you have in the field as long as it supports Passpoint or Hotspot 2.0. So, you know, if you have a MikroTiks or Cambiums or Calyxes or Alta, those already support Hotspot 2.0. So you can send a config to them to enable it to connect to the XNet network and get that Wi-Fi offload.
So you can, so just as a, you know, brief question, if you had a MikroTik, like I have a MikroTik router at my house, that's what I use, right, for my AP. And if it had Hotspot 2.0, I mean, I could register that thing. And like I said, I mean, it could potentially make money in my neighborhood with people offloading to it. Or do you have to have like, yeah, I mean, do you have to have a certain type of backhaul or connection to the internet rather than your, you know, Time Warner or your cable modem or whatever? It doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. It can go over your normal internet connection. Some of the projects like Helium, they have quality of service like requirements.
Right.
I think there's, you have to have at least 100 by 10, and then there's some latency and time requirements.
Yeah, but as long as your pipe is good enough, it will work.
Yeah. You know, essentially what they're doing is they are kind of replicate what the cable companies are doing. So, you know, Spectrum and Comcast and whoever, they have these millions of cable modems. Behind the scenes, they've enabled Wi-Fi on them. Like, you don't even see it in your house, but cell phone companies like Spectrum Mobile and Comcast Mobile, they're connecting to that. So you're driving down the street and everybody's connecting to your cable modem. But that's how those guys have been able to offload. I've heard something like 93% of their traffic goes over Wi-Fi instead of the cell towers. So they save a big, they save a lot of money. They don't have to pay Verizon or T-Mobile.
Well, I mean, even the cell phone company, right? So like I have T-Mobile, and when I'm at home, it's on Wi-Fi calling, right? So, I mean, every call that I make in and out, I just go over my internet connection and not touching their APs, which I'm kind of happy with because, I mean, the connection in my house was kind of crappy from T-Mobile, you know, natively for a while, and now it's better because it's doing it over Wi-Fi. And I'm kind of like in this little dead spot. So even when I like leave my house, you know, it's in like 20 seconds, I'm in coverage again, right? So it works well, so.
Yeah, you're currently located in the spite zone, so.
Yeah.
They've seen all your posts of complaining about the service, and they're like, all right, we're just going to block you off right here.
You will never get 5G. No 5G. This is the bandwidth Nazi.
Oh, God. Y'all remember when 5G was going to completely destroy the WISP industry like a year or two ago?
You know.
So many things.
I was thinking about that the other day. Like, we've lived through so much doom and gloom. It was like, you know, first Wild Blue and early
satellites. I forgot about that. Holy shit.
And then it was like, well, Clearwire is going to put us all out of business. And then it was, you know, whatever else. Starlink's going to put us out of business. 5G is going to put us out of business. But you know what? We're all still here. So
Yeah. I think just as a society, we love that drama, right? And it's like every new technology comes through, it just seems like it's the thing to do is to, oh my God, it's going to end, you know? But yeah,
it's the end of the world. But they're like super excited about all new stuff. That's the danger, though, is like, oh, well, this thing coming up is what's going to save us all. And I'm like, no, guys, it's just another tool in the toolbox.
Exactly. Yep.
You know, there's a lot of cool stuff. I mean, the maturation of the 60 gig sort of project or products and stuff, I mean, that's been really cool. There's a number of players, you know, Ubiquiti's really big with their Wave, but you got others, Tachyon's picking up, you know, you've got, you know, Cichlid and stuff's always been there. I mean, there's good stuff happening there. There's, of course, the 6 gig, which we're all very excited about, you know, as that picks up and starts gaining traction and running.
What are you doing for 6 gig? Or are you doing anything at 6 gig?
We have not done any 6 gig yet. Sort of following Cambium, I think people are still having some issues. I think they're working through some firmware stuff on that and some more AFC approvals. So we'll see how that goes. Kind of interested to see what Ubiquiti is going to come out with. That whole AirFiber MLO seemed really interesting at WISP America, combining mm-hmm. 5 and 6 together. That could be a game changer. So I guess we'll probably wait and see a little bit, you know, get our hands on some hardware and do some testing once it's out and approved.
Yeah, I expect to start seeing a lot of Wi-Fi 7 core stuff, you know, really start taking off probably next year, you know, at the earliest, realistically. But I think that's going to be the next sort of big jump in that sort of radio class gear. So we'll just see how long it takes to get it done, right? We've been waiting on AX for quite a while, and it's finally taken off and rolling. Now, of course, everyone's like, well, what's the next big thing? So as we all increment up a number or a few letters or something, so.
Yeah, I think a lot is coming. Someone at WISP told me that the FCC OET has like a backlog of approval, and that's one of the issues is there's a lot of hardware companies waiting on approvals for their hardware for 6 gigahertz.
Yeah, as I understand it, that whole process was kind of had to be reinvented, you know, because it's a different type of certification than the normal sort of standard Part 15 stuff that was done before. Yep. But, you know, we're seeing devices move. We're seeing stuff get certified, which for the longest time we weren't, right? And then they're like, okay, it's real. And I'm like, is this real, real? Real? Really?
So, is it real this time? I don't know.
But it looks like we're finally there. So expected much more of a big colossal boom or whatever. Then it was like, okay, guys, it's on. So let's do something. So,
yeah. So, you know, you mentioned competitive threats and in 5G. You know, one thing I'd like to say is I think the biggest threat really to WISP is just over government regulation. It seems like every other month there's just more and more regulation they're trying to force on our industry. And, you know, I see that as honestly the biggest threat to our members at to WISP.
Yeah. So maybe you can shed some light on that. I guess you're talking about kind of the recent net neutrality thing coming back, or is it coming back full time? They're thinking about it. Maybe you can give us a little update on what you know about that.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, net neutrality is obviously a big one. They did vote to reinstitute that. There are some temporary carve outs for small providers, but you know, overall it's coming back with a vengeance and a lot more regulation than the first time. Now the problem I see is it seems like the government likes to create a solution to a problem that isn't there, you know? But we haven't had net neutrality since 2015, so it's been 9 years. The internet seems to be operating fine. Mm-hmm. So I don't really understand why we need this regulation, but at the end of the day, it's all political. You know, some people in Washington decide what they want to do.
Well, it's their way of getting money, right? I mean, it's basically what it comes down to is there's more money for them to spend of ours, right? I mean, it's not their money. It's taxpayer dollars that get to be burnt up and given to their friends in these new, you know, committees and these new organizations who are now in charge of, you know, things that they don't even understand. So it's a shame.
You know, one thing that's interesting is, you know, before I joined WISP, I don't think I fully understood the graph of just how big the federal government is and how much bureaucracy there is. You know, like you think about Congress, all right, you got like 100 senators, you have 435 Congress people. So, wow, that's 500 people we updated once. But no, that's just the beginning. They each have a staff of, you know, in the House, they might have 10, 15 staff. In the Senate, they might have 30. So now we have thousands of people we need to talk to get our point across.
Mm-hmm.
Plus the House and Senate committees could have 50, 60, 70 people. I think I read the other day that there are 20,000 congressional staffers.
Wow. Jeez.
And about 30,000 people who work for the legislative branch and government. And it costs those taxpayers $6.7 billion a year to keep track of.
Yeah. Bloated.
That's crazy. Like, how do you influence 20,000 people? And that's just Congress. Then you have all the agencies who want their fingers in the pie. You have the FTC, FAA, NTA, USDA, Federal Trade Commission. The Department of Defense is big in the spectrum. They always want their fingers in there.
Yeah.
Department of Agriculture. It's just endless. There's just thousands and thousands and thousands of bureaucrats you have to go to just get anything done. And that's just the federal. Then you have 50 states, 50 governors, 50 government officers, 50 state legislators.
Yeah.
Then now you have counties that want to regulate broadband and get involved. And there's what, like 3,000 counties and cities and towns. I mean, there's probably hundreds of thousands of government bureaucrats who all want their say and their power over broadband. It's just insane.
Yeah, and you got to figure how many of these decision makers that are running this are old enough. You know, they grew up watching black and white TV for most of their formative years, right? And the computer was a thing that NASA had that was the size of a whole building. So, you know, fast forward 70 years later, and they're making these large nationwide doctrines about how technology works and have absolutely no comprehension of what actually makes it go. And even if you take a rosy-eyed view, as they're like, I want to do something good and help people. You're like, okay, that's great, but you don't understand. And there's 10,000 other people that are like, ah, we can help you for a modest price, right?
Yeah, so, right.
You know, anytime there's somebody trying to do good or bad, there's always somebody trying to make money on top of it, right? So it's, you know, in the end, it's amazing that anything actually gets done. But, I mean, you know, it does. And, you know, it's one of the things that we've harped on so much is, you know, it is a big, massive machine, but, you know, you're not necessarily like, okay, you've got to convince the president to make a decision. You know, so many policy things that works in your neighborhood is done at that local level. You know, we've harped on it so many times about, you know, getting involved with whether it's the city level, you know, county, municipality level and stuff, or, you know, up to state. You know, make your voice heard. And, you know, a lot of these people, if you've got a lot of small business, I mean, the political power of the small business, I think, is probably the highest it's ever been, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, you know, don't give up. Like, there's a lot of people that'll listen to the needs and requirements and wishes of a small business, because I think a lot of people are realizing that small businesses are what built this company or this country, you know?
Yep.
For as much as everyone's after that Apple and Google money, but in the grand scheme of things, you know, drive through any business park and there'll be 100 businesses full of places that you don't know what they're doing. Maybe they're making socks. Maybe they're making medical equipment. You don't know, but there's just thousands and thousands of these small businesses, and they've got a lot of traction right now. So, you know, remember that when you're working on that local level and trying to guide policy where you can, or, I don't know, at least understand where you're getting screwed from, I guess. Maybe you know it's actually coming.
You know who's screwing you, at least.
Yeah, right? You at least know what's coming.
Yeah, I think that's an important point. You know, we do have WISPA as an organization, and, you know, they have a bunch of staff and lobbyists and consultants, and those people are honestly very good at their jobs. But they're more like the special forces. They have a very specific mission, very specific point they're trying to get across to very specific people. And you can't win a war just with special forces. You need an army. And so we really need every WISP to be meeting with their Congress people, their state senators, their local community leaders, because, you know, that message needs to be heard way more broadly. And, you know, if we had all of our 900 members meeting with a few of their elected officials every few months, that would really help out. The campaign for our industry, I would say.
Yeah, that's one of the growth areas WISP, I think, has been really positive lately, is the ramping up of the state coordinators and, you know, whether it be a regional gathering. You know, we've got several of those coming up this spring and summer.
Yep, next week.
Yeah, or insert week here. This week, last week, depends when this goes out. But yeah, the Midwest one's coming up. We've got the Kentucky one, I know. There's several others. There's a lot of stuff going on in Florida, so... You know, these state coordinators are really working towards, you know, doing what we're talking about, like getting people organized in an area that understand, you know, your area, your demographics and stuff, and, you know, start trying to crack that nut in that area. And, you know, it's easy to focus on your Texas or Oklahoma, where, you know, there are so many big WISP base and stuff. But I mean, this is a nationwide effort. So,
yep.
And there's a lot of areas for progress in some of these smaller markets and smaller regions and stuff. So, yeah, there's nothing but potential out there. You really got to try, see what works and pivot where it doesn't and go forward where it does.
Yeah, I mean, it's really important to meet with them. You know, one thing is they would always rather meet with a small business owner, WISP owner, than a lobbyist, because lobbyists come in and out of their office like constantly every day. In fact, when we did the fly-in in DC, you know, a month ago, one of the offices told us that they had 30 meetings that day alone, which is crazy. So they had 30 different constituents or lobbying groups come in there, and like, how can you get your message across when there's just so much background noise? So that's why it's important to meet with them in your district, invite them out to your WISP, give them a tour, show them some towers. You know, that sort of personal relationship really helps.
100%, for sure. So cool. I mean, you know, we hit a lot of areas. We've been bouncing around here quite a bit, yeah. You know, as our normal meandering conversation goes. So I guess, Keith, you know, is there anything specific you want to soapbox on or take a stance or anything right now? You know, you've got an opportunity, or we're not, you know, we're not going to pressure the low pressure environment here. So,
you know, I just think the WISP industry is awesome. It's growing well. I think people shouldn't be worried. You know, government is going to do what government does. Competitors are going to do what competitors do. But in the end, if you can adapt, you'll survive. We're going to be here for a long time. I think WISP's been around for, what, maybe 30 years now, 25 years. We're going to be here another 25, 30 years, if not longer. You know, keep doing what you're doing. Like me, as a WISP guy, like, I feel like I'm in a situation that a lot of other smaller WISPs are in, where, like, I'm all in. Like, I don't just want the industry to survive. I need the industry to survive, because like, I don't have a house or a job or a vehicle or money if my WISP goes out of business. You know, you have a lot of things tied up when you're a small business owner. Yep. So, like, every day it's a fight between life or death of, you know, my company and other WISPs. Yeah. We just have to stick together, keep doing what we're doing, and win.
That's true. And it's not just about the WISP, too. I mean, if you just think about the entire ecosystem of businesses and small businesses that are wrapped up in supporting, from the hardware vendors, software vendors, and service providers, and everything else. I mean, they're all, you know, they're all dependent on this WISP thing continuing, you know, and we all need to get behind it and support the industry as a whole, for sure.
All right. So anyone, you know, looking to get in touch with you, or any questions or anything, what would be the best way to find you? LinkedIn, or do you want to throw an email address out? Or, I mean, it's up to you entirely. Facebook, you know, WISP.
Yeah,
I mean,
your home phone number, personal number?
Address, daily schedule.
Yeah. You know, LinkedIn or Facebook, I'm easy to find. I'm pretty much always on there.
Right on.
Probably too much.
For sure. So, all right. Again, we really appreciate you taking the time to talk to us today. Look forward to seeing you here. One of the shows, or, you know, worst case Vegas, is, like I said, it's coming. Yeah. So as hard as it is to believe, it's coming down the pipe.
I'll for sure be in Vegas.
Yep. We'll be there for sure, too. Toss says, anyone looking to find us, where's the best place for them to do that?
Yeah, absolutely. You can find us all over social media, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. You can find us on our website, rfelements.com. You can email us, tasos@rfelements.com, caleb@rfelements.com. Just go out there, look for us, and you'll find us.
All right, everyone. So I guess until next time, y'all be good, do good, keep up the good fight. Rah, rah, rah. Let's get it done.
Yeah.
All right.
Later.
Bye, everybody.
See ya.
Bye.